Next presentation then is going to be presented by Kathleen Deckers from Tübingen University. And she will be, I will let her introduce the rest of her team as she wishes. The title of the talk is Vegetation Reconstruction in the Class. That's the Climate, Landscape, Settlement and Society Project. Kathleen, please.
Yes, thank you very much. There was a bit of hectic behind the screens, but yeah. I'm glad to be here.
Take your time. No problem. We're doing fine.
Yeah. So welcome to our presentation on vegetation reconstruction in the CLAS project, which stands for Climate, Landscape, Settlement and Society, exploring human-environment interactions in the ancient Near East. The CLAS project is directed by Dan Lawrence and financially supported by the ERC. And it investigates the relationship between climate fluctuations and settlement history over the last 8,000 years in the Near East. And here you can see a map that shows the enormous database of settlements that has been gathered in the CLAS project and which forms the basis of many archaeological questions. There's a huge data set of more than 100,000 settlements dating to the last 8,000 years. And they have been mapped, and also their chronological span has been added into more detail to the database. We also know that the climate has fluctuated in the last 8,000 years in the Near East. And here you can see a recent summary that shows you some paleoclimatic proxies and also an indication of the climate becoming wetter or drier. And we also see here on this figure, like for example, the well-known aridity peaks, like the 4.2 kilo annum event, 3.2 kilo annum event, that have been argued to have impacted human societies.
Kathleen, I am the technician, Can you click on Ausblenden?
Yes.
Well, thank you. Go on. Okay. Sorry.
In the CLAS project, we want to go into more depth into the causes for observed settlement changes. So we want to go beyond simplistic conclusions like observing settlement collapse contemporary with aridity peaks, concluding that then it was caused by this. And an important part of this project is understanding more detailed the causal chains. Therefore, archaeozoology and also archaeobotany, including anthracology, are an important part of the project. Anthracology, the investigation of charcoals, plays a key role in the reconstruction of woody vegetation in much of the Near East, since palynological research is often hampered by poor pollen preservation. And today I'm going to show you some of the anthracological work in the project. And the anthracological work is focusing on the questions of understanding the impact of people versus climate on the vegetation and the implications of for human societies. Additionally, we especially want to gain a more detailed understanding of fruit tree cultivation, its intensification, and involved landscape modifications. So these are very big questions, and we are addressing these by a working program consisting of database work, new charcoal identifications, diameter and annual ring width measurements, and integration with fruit and seed data. And all of this, of course, happens with the integration of archaeology at different levels. Let's first have a look at the database work within the project. An important part of the project consists of adding all published anthropological studies from within the study area into ADEMNES. This is the online accessible archaeobotanical database of Eastern Mediterranean and Near Eastern sites that currently contains mostly seed data and only limited charcoal data. So the charcoal data are entered into the database on a sample by sample basis, and special attention is paid to contextual and chronological control. And Valentina Tomolo, especially in the project, plays an important role in this for the checking of the chronology and of the anthropological samples. Besides adding published anthropological data, we are also producing new anthropological data with samples being studied from many sites in the region. So you can see here all the sites with a black label that are currently being studied. For example, we recently published new data on two early Bronze Age Levantine sites, Padus and Serakon, where we had a lot of olive charcoal, probably related with olive cultivation. We also recently worked on charcoal material from Tawilam, where a lot of shrub diameter charcoals were found, and only a few charcoals from trees were found. New charcoal work was also done on Katna, where we have very interesting kitchen refuse from the late Bronze Age. And I recently also investigated new charcoal samples within the DFG-funded Zingerli project under the direction of Virginia Herman. And this data will then also be added to the database. So lots and lots of samples and single sites are being added to the database. And eventually we want to understand vegetation changes over larger regions. And today we will be zooming in to the region of northern Syria, southern Turkey, so the region that is indicated by this red rectangle. We will especially have a more detailed look at the sites Gerablus and Tel Mozam in this region and use preliminary database results to contextualize the results from Mozam and Gerablus. At Mozam, we have the remains of an early Bronze Age site, so a 3rd millennium BC settlement that became a huge city between 2600 and 2300 BC. And afterwards, population decline took place, but the site was continually occupied between the early and the middle Bronze Age. At Gerablus, we have the remains of a smaller site, founded in the 4th millennium BC, originally probably an Uruk colony, and afterwards in the 3rd millennium BC, smaller, it is a smaller site, more kind of outpost site. Both sites receive approximately the same rainfall levels today, around 400 millimeters annually, according to the TAVO maps from the 1980s. Not even 100 millimeters annually, according to the recent weather station data that can be accessed online. While Mozam is in the Kabul Basin plain and was not located along a permanent stream, of course, Gerablus is located on the bank of the Euphrates. And the Euphrates today still has some riparian woody vegetation, but away from the river, hardly any woodland is present. And this is also true for the Mozam surroundings, where we can hardly detect a tree in the surroundings. Here you can see the charcoal identification results from Mozam, and you can see that oak dominates the charcoal results, so the charcoal fragments, so the charcoal samples in the early Bronze Age, and then it is still present in the middle Bronze Age, but in a smaller proportion. We also have acorns. So oak appears to have been locally present, just like we also have an oak proportion at other sites in this region, like, for example, Tel Elam, Tel Atich, Deri, and then also in the Middle Bronze Age at Shagar Bazar. Interestingly, also amongst the Gerablus charcoal remains, a proportion of oak was found. Of course, the charcoal remains from Gerablus are dominated by riverine taxa like poplar, willow, tamaricks. So all these in black and gray here. But this is expectable considering the location along the Euphrates. And also here we can detect a proportion of deciduous oak at other anthropologically investigated sites in northern Syria, in the middle Euphrates region. And it is often a very small proportion, not so well visible in the cake diagrams, because the vegetation is dominated by the riverine gallery forest. But you can see here in more detail the percentages of oak woodland in the different sites here, documented by the cake diagrams. And it is of note here that, for example, in Emar, we have no oak, and this is a site that is located rather far south with the least rainfall levels, so probably it was too arid up there. So we seem to have had oak woodland in the past into northern Syria, and we can question how did it look like and how did people use this woodland, and can we find any indications for woodland management for Jurablus and Mozan? And here we come to the third part of the project. It is the charcoal measurements. More precisely, we can investigate woodland management practices through measuring the diameter of the last annual annual ring present on the charcoal fragment. And this hasn't been done very often so far in Near Eastern archaeological anthropological studies. The method is even stronger when we combine it in with ring annual ring width data. And this is exactly what we've done then. We've measured 329 oak fragments from Mozan and Jurablus, and also more than 1,100 annual ring widths from those samples. And subsequently, we calculated an average growth rate for each fragment that then was used to calculate an approximate cambial age for the last annual ring present. So basically a calculation for how old the trunk or branch was when it formed this annual ring. Interestingly, the data show that quite small oak diameters were used, smaller than would be expected from the use of trunks from fully grown trees. So the median of diameters for the different periods and the size lays between 3 and 5 centimeter, which is quite low. And also 75% of the samples have a diameter less than 10 centimeter. You can see here the same data actually depicted in another way in diameter classes. And so this is here the date or data from Jurablus and Mozan, and you can see that we have quite a lot of fragments with a diameter of less than 5 centimeters. When we compare this to Kaman Kalihiuk, this is a site in central Anatolia, quite far away from our site, but this is so far the only site that we can compare our data with. There we have quite much more large diameters. And another interesting thing is here, for example, the reference material. So this is a 15 centimeter diameter log that has been charred. And you can see that it proportionally has much less fragments of the class less than 5 centimeters. So having all these small diameters, at first we were wondering whether we had evidence of urban societies managing their oak woods, for example, through coppicing, it is cutting down to near ground level to grow new shoots, or pollarding, the cutting to the main stem or trunk, encouraging lateral branches. And here you can see an example of typical oak management from Iran today. And in Iran, such oak harvesting cycles mostly only take 4 years. And the maximal cycle I found in literature was said to be 35 years. And here you can see our data depicted. So here you can see the approximate cambial age of the last annual ring and the number of samples in these groups here. And you can see that that more than half of the measurements was more than 35 years old. Only 16 fragments had a minimal estimated cambial age below 10 years, while only 3 were below 4 years. So the data do not show systematic woodland management. Instead, a lot of small diameters were actually due to slow growth. And on this graph, you can see that a large proportion of the fragments actually had a slow growth rate of less than 0.5 millimeters. So this is the gray zone here, the light gray zone, the lightest gray. So this one here. 100-year-old trunk from an oak with only a growth rate of 0.5 millimeters would only be approximately 10 centimeter wide. Even a slow growth of only 0.20 millimeter was found as well. That the oak was likely not part of a dense oak forest, instead was more a kind of shrub, is also indicated by the fact that dung was used as an additional fuel at Mozam in the 3rd millennium BC. So you see here 3 oven contexts from Mozam, and in this one here we have a dung pellet, and then here this oven context was dominated by seeds and fruits, so there was no charcoal in there, and a lot of wild seeds that is also indicative of dung as fuel. The upper Khabur Basin was intensively inhabited in the 3rd millennium BC, and on this map you can see the hollow ways that have been interpreted to delineate the boundary of the zone of the fields surrounding the settlements. And this indicates that a large part of the plain was used for agriculture. And we know from texts and also from archaeological remains that urban institutions controlled large herds of sheep and goats, for example, from Tel Bedar in this region here. The texts indicate that Bedar controlled about 7,400 sheep and goats. And for Ibla, the texts indicate even more enormous flocks of sheep and goats, especially sheep there. In total, 670,000 are reconstructed based on the texts. And these huge numbers of animals, however, only had restricted areas that could be grazed if we consider here the map of the delineation by the hollow ways. So a lot of it was in fact agricultural lands. And this may also explain the slow growth of the oak, especially herbivore browsing is known to cause slow growth in trees, especially near the border of its habitat. So we also have some morphological indications for possible herbivore browsing impact on the morphology of oak fragments, like, for example, the lack of early wood vessels, irregular animal rings, disoriented structures, false animal rings, discontinuous stick rays, and vessel collapse. We have this evidence for oak shrub, possibly caused by strong herbivore browsing, and the presence of oak shrub as established through anthropology matches quite well with the seed and fruit data from the sites in the surrounding. Michel de Cruchy made these maps here of potential vegetation based on GIS modeling of the seed and fruit data from the archaeobotanical database. And these maps show that during the early Bronze Age, dry shrub steppe occurred in the upper Khabur Basin. And this map, of course, does not take into account agricultural zones. And last week, however, Michel overlaid the hollow ways that can be used as a proxy for the extension of the fields to this map. And interestingly, there seems to be quite an overlap of the agricultural land with the dry shrub steppe. from the early to the middle Bronze Age, this shrub steppe appears to have decreased strongly. Interestingly, at Mozan, at that time, we see also a strong decrease in the oak proportion and have instead more evidence for olive charcoal. At Mozan, they also seem to have cut some older trees at that time. So you see here the median and the upper whisker of the ages of the last annual ring is higher than for any of the other periods at that time. Besides people, also climate may have played a role in the observed reduction of oak. There was the well-known 4.2 kiloannon event, the aridity peak, and that preceded the Middle Bronze Age. And it is possible that we can see the 4.2 kiloannon event in our annual ring width data. So here within the samples of 2100 to 2000 BC at Mozan. Although no statistically significant differences in the mean could be detected, in the box plots, we can observe a lower proportion of oak with good growing conditions compared to the other periods. So the other periods have a larger proportion of good growth years. Yeah. Possibly we can see the result of early Bronze Age anthropogenic impact combined with climatic drying on the oak woodlands. So the early Bronze Age population seems to have grown beyond sustainability with a huge area taken up by fields, intensive herding in the remaining oak woodland, and a lack of woodland management, and upon overall aridity increase, especially the 4.2 kiloannon BP aridity peak, they were vulnerable to desertification. As a conclusion, we can say that oak vegetation had a more southward distribution in the mid-Holocene. However, it was not pristine in the period under investigation. Already from the Chalcolithic onwards, settlements seem to have had impact on the vegetation, especially through herding within the oak woodland. The land was used intensively for agricultural purposes in the early Bronze Age, so that not much land for pasture was available, which may also have put pressure on the oak. Additionally, no specific oak woodland management could be observed, such as coppicing or pollarding, and dung was used as an additional fuel that indicates that there may have been some kind of shortness in woody resources. The vegetation changes from observed from the early Bronze Age to the middle Bronze Age are possibly the result of long unsustainable anthropogenic impact under aridification, making the land then prone to desertification. Notwithstanding this, by the end of the period under consideration, the vegetation appears to have still been lusher than today, with oak still having a more southwards distribution than today. So this case study shows how anthropology can contribute to archaeological questions of land use, resource management, and settlement collapse, which will be addressed further in the class project in different regions and periods, and also at a larger scale. I would like to thank you for your attention. And I would like to thank also the excavators of the site, Peter Felsner, Giorgio Buccellati, Marilyn Kelly Buccellati, and Edgar Peltenberg, who sadly passed away. And this project was funded through the ERC. So thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen. Very, very interesting material and exciting developments that have been a part of this class project. And just to let you know, Dan has been answering some of your questions, so perhaps giving you a break, but I don't feel like I should let you completely off. I do want to ask maybe one quick, it's a big question though, I suppose it's maybe not fair, but I'm also very interested in trying to get a sense of how perhaps the data, the different categories of data that you've been working on with this larger Middle Eastern or Near Eastern context might connect to some of these larger global projects like the Landcover 6K in this case. And I know this is probably a question Dan would like to answer, but I was thinking of putting it to you and if you had some kind of brief response about that before we move to the next presentation.
Yeah, we are in contact actually, so there is a close connection between the projects.
Okay, well, I'll let it go at that, and thank you again very much. And we look forward to hearing more about the results of this ongoing research in future sessions as well. Thank you.
Okay.